And that's exactly what digital technique did to us.
Okay, but if you haven't made a solo disc since 1990, you have made concerto recordings in the last 18 years, and the most recently is Brahms' first piano concerto, Simon Rattle and the Berlin Philharmonic. Are you still frustrated with the recording?
Orchestra, it's a little bit easier for me. At first, I have a listener. There's 60 people sitting next to me. And we kind of, the adrenaline starts to work between us. It's very important. And they also make a lot of noise, so it's the basic silence is not dead. And it is while you're recording yourself. So it's slightly easier, and that's why most of my recordings are concertos. And actually, most of these concerto recordings are actually live.
But you're happy with them? I mean, you're happy with these recordings?
I'm not happy with recordings at all. And I don't advise anybody to buy my records. I always listen to them once, and after I have to approve them. And I always approve them under stress and under the pressure of the company.
So there's a paradox here, because I know that you record everything you do, all your concerts. You have a library of all of your concerts. So
you're saying I'm trying to get friend of this monster, which is on the other side of the microphone.
But it is the other monster, yourself. Does it pain you to listen to yourself, that you listen and you're very critical of what you hear and you think, oh, I should have done it differently, or, you know, this isn't really my version of this piece, I need to do it again?
You know, in various stages of my musical consciousness, I'll put it this way, I listen to different things. And again, in the last 10 years, I'm listening to the flow of music. And what I like mostly to listen, I like to listen in the car. I got rid of all this fantastic equipment I had before. I have really small machines which you can put in the pocket today. And if I really want to hear music, I put it into my car and I drive around the house. Because then my conscious part of the brain is occupied with the road. And the music goes right there where it should go. And I was always curious, why is it this way? Why do I hear so clearly what's wrong in the record when I'm in the car? And you know, the basic noise of the car is covering all the details. So I stop listening to details. My mind stops being distracted by the details. And I listen to that what in the music is the most important, telling the story.
Concentrated on the music rather than the driving.
Well, let's put it this way. I'm trying to do it late at night and looking for empty roads in case the recording is really bad.
Are you listening mostly to yourself?
No, to record. I never listened after I approved the record. And so I don't know what you're talking about when you say, you know, the old record of this or that. It's difficult for me to say. But yes, I'm listening to concerts occasionally, especially when they are bad, then I'm curious to listen
your
to
own concerts.
What's wrong.
And what relationship do you have with yourself when you're listening to these concerts? I mean, can you give me an example of a concert you've listened to recently?
It's like, you know, I know more about this guy than anybody else. So it's a very special relationship. It's like listening to your own voice or looking at the mirror at your own face. The same is with music. It's very difficult to listen to oneself so that you can hear yourself clearly. You have always an excuse because you know why you did this way. And you will always go in the other direction that you hear more details than the other person. Maybe these details don't matter at all.
It's a sort of paradox in a way, though, that you have allowed so few recordings, proportionally, if you like, to be authorized by you and released, and yet you record every concert you do.
No, but I don't record it to sell it. You know, if you allow a record in the market, you should be convinced that the record is something enriching the market, that it can give something to the people, something nobody else gave before you. if it's a mediocre record and you're just releasing it because you recorded it, I think this motivation is wrong.
Because it's also true to say that for the people who haven't had the chance to see you live, they may not know that the repertoire you play in concert is much bigger clearly than your discography, and also then presumably that means that the music that you play at home and that you're listening to and working on is also much bigger than
than the repertoire you play in concert. It's maybe 1% of what I work on at home.
1%?
Yeah. I work every night on pieces which I've never played in my life. I worked yesterday on Florian Schmidt. I worked the night before on Rossini piano pieces, and I listened the night before to symphonies of Parry and Rubra, and it's something I'll never conduct. I'm curious. I'm simply curious because it's so many interesting things, and after I analyzed this Rossini, I thought before Rossini died in 48, you know, after he wrote the last opera, he must have died. And then I realized he lived another 40 years, didn't write one single opera. And wrote about, 1,300 piano pieces. And looking at them, I realized that I know where Eric Satie is coming from, only 20 titles later. And he had a tremendous influence over the French music of Alcan, of Satie and others.
Mm-hmm. How then do you make the decision, the pieces you're working on? You work mostly at night, is that right?
Yes.
You literally play through the night.
Oh, decision is, it's difficult to say.
I mean, so how do you make a decision then to present something in concert?
Difficult to say. How do you make a decision what you eat in a restaurant? I mean, do you know this 1 year in advance?
No, but I suppose I eat what I want to, as opposed to eating 1% of what I want to. Whereas, from what you're saying, if you present to the public 1% of what you can play and do play at home, that's a...
You know, I have to have a motivation that I want to play this piece at this moment. And I need the audience for this, because I never play for myself. I work at home in a studio, and then for the first time I hear this piece, from the beginning till the end, actually in a concert hall. And it's a tremendous risk. And it's wrong. I absolutely don't advise it to any student to do this kind of thing. But I couldn't do it at home. It's like, you know, talking to the mirror, I love you, and looking what are the lips doing at this moment. You need the addressee, you need the person, you need to have the feeling, and then the words will come by itself, and maybe it will sound completely different than what you meant before. And that's what the exciting thing of the concert is. The interpretation is made actually together with the people, with the audience. I have a very precise ideas of what I want to do. I'm prepared, of course, technically. I have at least 3 sets of fingerings, which I change according to the acoustic and to the power I use in various concert halls.
3 ways of fingering each piece?
Sometimes more. So I am prepared for a concert, but the final thing, that what art is made of, actually happens in a concert hall.
So in a sense, you can't know a piece of music, however much you've studied, say, the piano music, however much you know about those things, however much you know the notes.
You know, some pieces I carry around for years. A lot of pieces, the recent pieces I play, I worked for 10, sometimes more years. So I'm playing a new piece just this season, which I worked on for almost 25 years. It doesn't mean every day I was practicing this piece, no. I sort of worked one day and then left it and then worked again half a year later and so on. And some new ideas were growing, and eventually I realized, okay, I have the piece now. I want to try it. I want to do it.
Which piece is that?
I can't tell you.
Are you going to be playing it in May?
I'm too ashamed to tell you.
Are you going to be playing it in May when you come to...
Probably, yeah.
Okay, well, there's something to listen out for, because you won't announce the program until later. But obviously, no.
You know, I would really like to play the piece I want to play that evening. And not to announce the program a year in advance and then come to the concert, oh my God, now I have to play this piece.
But you already leave it much later than many other people to announce your programs, and people will be aware of that. For example,
or the other way around. People do it much earlier than I do it.
There's another paradox about it. It's all the preparation that you go into, so that in a sense you know what you're going to do when you play to an audience. You know what fingering you're going to use. If you're in a big hole, you'd use one.
I don't know.
You don't?
No.
Because I guess what I mean is, what's the difference between preparing so minutely your interpretations and the spontaneity of what can happen in that communication?
I mean, you know, you're preparing 2 different things. I mean, you're preparing a craftsmanship, you're preparing all the versions of what could happen.